Welcome back to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. It's no secret that Republican policies are bad for the American public almost exclusively these days. If you need hard evidence, just take a look at the Deep South. On everything from economic issues to social issues, the Republican-controlled South is a warning to the rest of the country about the dangers of Republican policies. Joining me now to talk about that is Howard Nations. Howard, a friend of mine, Thomas Frank, wrote a book, What's the Matter with Kansas, many years ago. Now, it seems like it must have been 11, 12 years ago. It's been around a long time. And he tried to understand what in the world is happening to Kansas, because you had this problem where they had one of the lowest economic mobility problems. They had one of the lowest education problems. They had minimum wage problems. They had health problems. They stacked up in the United States as being just a dismal place to live. And he decided that what was happening is those people in Kansas wanted to vote for guns and God in cultural issues, and basically to hell with their children. You see that happening in almost across the board in the South, in the solid South right now, don't you?
We absolutely do see that happening in the South. There have been a lot of studies on that recently. But, you know, frankly, the starting point of it, as far as I'm concerned, is that they are solidly Republican. And this is how the Republicans choose to govern. They cut budgets, they oppose the minimum wage, they oppose labor unions, they refuse federal aid, and they oppose everything that supports the poverty safety net. For example, in Texas, our governor and several other governors are refusing health care, Medicaid for the poor. And Texas has the largest uninsured health care population in the country, but we're refusing federal funding that would pay 90% of it. Why? Political reasons. Solely to make Obamacare fail. But the answer to the question is, why is it still the same? Republicans use the poor as political pawns. They place politics above people and the poor. They manipulate the voting rules. They disenfranchise the poor voters and the young. And they gerrymander the districts to assure their own reelection to make sure it stays that way.
Now, it's a winning.
Not to let the Democrats off the hook, though.
Yeah, I was just going to say.
When the Democrats did exactly the same thing when they were in charge in the South, and the reason for that is simple. It's the same people. It's the white male leadership in the South that has always run the small businesses and been in charge in the South. They switched to the Republican Party after the Civil Rights Bill and the Voting Rights Act were passed. So it's the same regardless of whether it's Democrats or Republican, because it's the same people.
If you go back and look at the 60s, you had the kind of what they call the business elite,
right?
Which, as you described, were, you know, small to large business owners that had direct interest in trying to keep people stupid, not pay wages, accomplish a lot of, not have unions, a lot of things you just talked about.
Right.
And so all they've done is they've taken the D that used to behind their name, and now they've put an R there, and it's the same thing. One thing that I saw a great article in Salon.com about the Dixieland dilemma, and it was kind of the same thing that Thomas Frank was talking about, and that is, why do people allow it? Why does somebody in the South allow themselves to be paid the lowest wage per capita, to have no minimum wage increase at all? To have education just absolutely dysfunctional, to where kids don't even finish school, and if they finish school, they're not equipped for anything else, to where they're not able to organize for things like collective bargaining. They're willing to allow their environment to be just totally trashed by whoever wants to trash it. Why does that happen, and what's the reaction? And Thomas Frank said kind of the same thing Salon.com said, and that is that a lot of these people have such a religious background that they believe that simply praying to God is going to change all that. That's where they find their power, in their prayer. And there's nothing wrong with that. We all find power in prayer. But you don't change politics through prayer. And the other thing that they find power in is owning the gun. And so Thomas Frank says, why do they gravitate to those two things? And it is because they're powerless everywhere else. What's your take on that, Howard?
Well, I think that's absolutely right. And this all goes back, Pap, to the Southern strategy. It goes all the way back to Nixon after the Civil Rights Bill. And then in 1969, when Nixon came along, he was getting absolutely no support from the South at all. So he had to figure out a way to tap into exactly what you're talking about. So the Republicans adopted a phony platform that they didn't believe in, but they tapped into the anti-federalism, they tapped into the pro-gun, they tapped into the high level of religious and the anti-union sentiments that take place in the South, and they successfully converted Democrats to Republicans, not just the leaders, not just the white male leaders, but the entire South, by tapping into those exact things you're talking about.
These numbers that we're talking about, as far as, we're not just making this up, they looked at the extensive studies, and it wasn't just, it was the Department of Agriculture, they measure poverty, for example. It was two or three universities, and they looked at Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Arkansas, Louisiana, Alabama, Mississippi, Kentucky, Tennessee, West Virginia, Georgia, South Carolina. Oddly enough, North Florida, too, was included in all that. And so what they found is it's a common ground issue. The common ground is they're willing to sit at a table with their family and say to little Johnny, you know, it's okay that you're not educated because we have our guns. They're able to say to their wife, it's okay that you don't have equal protection as a female in this state because we have the right to religion, as if that was going to be tested anyway. So they have this notion that there's power in those two things, in owning handguns, and that the power of prayer is going to solve everything. And you have these characters that you're describing, they used to be Democrats and now they're Republican, that have these people under their thumb with that, don't they? They control them with those two things. They hustle them with those two things. They lie to them with those two concepts. And it's very effective, isn't it?
It's extremely effective. And the result of it is that across the South, you have the highest poverty in the country. This is a ridiculous figure. 25% of children in the South live in poverty. That's an amazing statistic. And when they say the South on that one, they're talking about a 2,500-mile area from Arizona all the way over to South Carolina. And here's the other reason, if you get right down to it. When we're talking about the people, the large level percentage of poverty, only 15 to 20% of those people are white. The 80 to 85% are minorities. And so in the South, they won't pass a minimum wage. They're totally against it. And the reason is because the business model in the South for businesses is low wage.
It's a Saipan model, which is totally. Basically no wages, and employer calls all the rules. Employees have nothing to say about how they're treated, basically.
Exactly.
That was launched by the Waltons, right? I mean, that's what we started singing.
Exactly. Very successfully by the Waltons, incidentally.
Yeah.
They also have the lowest economic mobility. You know, the politicians espouse the American dream. Work hard and you can climb the economic ladder. But statistically, it's just that. It's a dream. Because the poor cling to this hope of eternal life that you're talking about. And this is why a lot of the minorities celebrate death, because they're going on to a greater life. They've just resolved themselves that they're not going to get anything here. There is no economic mobility out of the South for minorities particularly. And they're never going to get out as long as we allow the business models to remain the same and be based on low wage work and not pass minimum wages.
In other words, Howard, you're saying that they've given up. They've been beat down to the point they've given up. And the two things they won't give up is this fear that somebody's going to take their religion and this fear that somebody's going to take their gun. Both of them absolutely ridiculous, but they buy into it anyway. A lot of it's self-imposed. There's very little what we can do about it sometimes. Howard Nations, thank you for joining me, okay?
My pleasure, Mike.